Hey, welcome back! Today, despite the price of gold being even at all-time highs recently, gold mining stocks don't really follow and several companies are pretty much at the same level as half a decade ago. Gold is up like 50% from that level, while the stocks are close to some of the lowest prices in almost a decade. And yes, the production cost is generally up, but it's nothing in comparison to how much the price of gold went and could still go up. Anyway, I believe that the best way to take advantage of this discrepancy is by investing in a company or companies that will likely be around for a very long time. To do that, a relatively low all-in sustaining cost and good financials are pretty much mandatory. That way, a company would be able to survive and even thrive, maybe even indefinitely, even in a bad scenario. Something you are about to see for almost every company is that the free cash flow is relatively low despite the high price of gold. That is usually because of higher capital expenditures, and if you think about it from the miner's perspective, it makes sense. You know, the classic commodity company, if you have a lot of money to invest or do some big maintenance project, it's during a time like today. You will see both the sustaining and the growth capex going up, which has an effect on the all-in sustaining cost, but more on that a bit later. However, keep in mind that some of the increase in production cost comes from inflation, and there is nothing they can do about that. Before we begin, I want to emphasize that I'll only look into the companies that do the mining themselves. In this industry, we also have royalty companies that fund the projects of other companies without doing the mining. I looked into a couple of those in the previous video about gold, but they are much more expensive in comparison. They are very good companies with little to no debt, but for what they can make and give back to us, they are not attractive at all. As you are about to see, this, let's say, cheapness is present only in the mining companies. Gold is a bit different from other commodities because a majority of the demand comes from investing and banks. What's very interesting, and I think has a lot of potential today, is the way gold reacts to interest rates as a result. We can see, especially lately, how the price goes up or down following news related to rate cuts, and when the rates actually get back to almost nothing, gold might be much higher than today. To understand it, think about where the money would go. If the rates are high, then treasuries pay you like 4-5% per year, while gold pays no interest and maybe offers inflation protection. However, when treasuries pay you close to nothing again because the rates are back to zero, then that 0% yield plus maybe inflation protection from gold suddenly becomes a much more attractive option. You know, this is not for you and me, this is for banks, pension, hedge, investment funds and so on, which have the majority of money and consequently dictate the price. This is similar for other investments, especially dividend stocks. One thing you'll see is that unlike other commodities, like lithium or copper, you can see my videos here by the way, there aren't that many investments that would increase the supply of gold. We can see the big companies investing like $1 billion on average into expansion, but most of what they do is consolidation, meaning investing in other mining companies, which is a net zero for the supply. So the supply would basically remain the same or even decrease, while the demand, especially after a rate cut, should go up. The longer this happens, the higher the price gets. And another consequence of this that's extremely rare for commodities, which makes gold almost unique, China doesn't account for too much of the demand. They are estimated to represent around 20-30% of the total demand, which compared to 50 to even 80% as with a majority of commodities, is very small. Who knows, maybe gold can get to even 2,500 per ounce, which would be really good for any mining company out there. Not only that, but the high interest rates also have a negative effect on the miners, and when they are finally cut, this can be a double boost for gold mining companies. To begin with Barrick, they are one of the top gold companies on the planet with high quality gold and copper assets in the Americas and Africa. They can produce about 4 million ounces of gold and about 200,000 tons of copper at acceptable prices. In the future, with the projects, they can even get to 6 or 7 million gold equivalent ounces. To be fair, they can probably buy another company in a couple of years and reach the same target. The all-in sustaining cost was high, but as you are about to see later in the video, this is a common trend in the industry and at the current price of gold, even 1.4 thousand per ounce should be good. But you know, the lower the better. Following some maintenance and expansion that affected production in the first half and 2 years ago, they made an almost $650 million cash flow last year. Most of this was in Q3, but keep in mind the changes in working capital that can influence this quite a bit, so looking at the whole year is usually better. I'd wait to see maybe Q1 and Q2 this year and see how the last 12 months of normal production were. They see capex of about 2.5 to 2.9 billion this year, which for the same cash from operations is a free cash flow of around 1 billion. That's not very good for a 25 billion market cap, but about a billion of that capex goes into developing projects and the cash from operations of last year was affected. We've seen them make 2 or even more than 3 billion at the current price of gold, which would be much more attractive. The dividend is gonna depend on the net cash they have. The base is 40 cents per year, but if they reach over 1 billion, which can be done in a good year, they can pay as much as $1. Today that's like 2.5 to 6.5%, but the idea is that if there is a good year, it can be enough to secure a nice dividend for 3-4 years ahead. That can be enough time to get to another good year. And you know, if you manage to buy this at like 10, then you can get a very nice dividend even after a good year. They have current assets of 7.4 billion, which is enough to offset the current liabilities like 3 times. Overall, considering the long-term assets, they have very nice financials. Again, in a good year, they can reach the net cash target and secure a very nice dividend. If we see gold at something like 2,500 per ounce, this can easily happen. Not only that, but this would probably double or maybe even more than triple. The upside and downside should be similar for most of the big mining companies. In a bad scenario, despite being relatively cheap, they can go down like 50% or even more. If we see gold stabilizing at around 2000 per ounce, any of these companies can go up 50 to even 100% or even more, and this would allow them to develop and also stabilize or do restructurings or whatever they need. I think resilience, meaning good financials and a low all-in sustaining cost, plus a distribution policy that would allow the shareholders to enjoy the good times, are probably the most important factors. I have Barrick already and this is a good price in my opinion. There is good potential, they are investing, the company is growing, they are profitable and the financials are very nice. Now let's get to Newmont. They recently bought Newcrest, an Australian gold miner that was making around $500 million to $1.5 billion and had a very low all-in sustaining cost of around 1.1 thousand. This was pretty expensive, but Newcrest was a very high quality company, so it's overall an improvement for Newmont. We are gonna have to wait and see more data to know what they can actually make together, but for being twice as expensive as Barrick, Newmont is not making that much more money. In fact, before Newcrest, they were actually pretty similar, even though Newmont was producing more gold. They also tend to have a higher all-in sustaining cost than Barrick, but with Newcrest, maybe they can get on the same level, but once again, we don't have the data yet. Similar to Barrick, they produce a bit of copper as well and about half of it comes from the Americas. They plan on doing some optimizations and improvements, which could generate over 3 billion in the near future. They made a free cash flow of only 88 million last year, but this includes about half a billion in working capital changes and 150 million in transaction related payments. So more like 700 million without them, which is still not great, but this is with 2.7 billion in capex, which is relatively high. I think it's very good that they focus on optimizing the portfolio because the all-in sustaining cost is kind of getting out of hand. Anyway, if they manage to reduce it by half a billion per year by selling some underperforming assets, that's already a very good improvement. But again, it's gonna take a bit of time until we see the merger in full effect. The current assets cover the current liabilities by a bit, which is okay, and they don't have a lot of debt. There are, however, other liabilities to worry about, although they are overall well covered by the non-current assets. So, not bad, especially after a merger that is generating short-term costs. I have a bit of Newmont, and I think that considering the Newcrest deal, it's pretty much the same investing thesis as Barrick. Very nice production, good financials, okay production cost when adjusting for Newcrest and overall a solid company. Overall, from a free cash flow point of view, I think Barrick is better at the current prices. You know, for me this is about gold getting a boost following the rate cuts in the medium term, but also about a very long term. I wouldn't mind paying a fair price if it means that the company will be there and do well if gold ever gets to 3000 or even more. Now let's get to AngloGold Ashanti. They are a South African company with operations in Africa, the Americas and Australia valued at around 7 billion. They can produce around 2.5 million ounces, meaning a bit more than half of Barrick, making them one of the largest gold producers on the planet. Again, the all-in sustaining cost is high, around 1,400, but if you think about it, this increase in the average cost of production everywhere in the industry can be good for the price of gold. That's because if the price now falls to, let's say, 1,500 per ounce, many mines would already have issues. This would affect the supply and could result in an increase in the price. Again, commodities are all about supply and demand. The all-in sustaining cost is expected to reach 1.5 to 1.6 thousand this year, so perhaps even more than the last. They have almost as many tier 1 assets as Barrick, which is not bad for a company that's 3 times smaller. These mines bring a majority of the money and have a better cost of production. They recently bought an 11.7% stake in another miner, and we can see other growth initiatives recently, especially in the past couple of years. One thing to consider with the smaller players is the potential to be bought by a bigger one, like Newmont did with Newcrest. But this can also be a risk if you buy at high prices, so having a margin of safety is even more important. They started improving in the second half of the year, recovering the negative cash flow and finishing the year with 109 million. They see the capex growing and the production increasing over the next couple of years as the new projects become operational and they help ramp up the production. I don't have the latest balance sheet because they haven't published it yet, but this one should be okay too. They had current assets of around 1.86 billion and 857 million in current liabilities. The non-current liabilities reach 3 billion, but they are well covered by the non-current assets, so they should be fine from this point of view. Overall, this company is not really that great considering the very high all-in sustaining cost. Maybe if they sell some of the non-tier 1 mines that have a very high production cost or keep doing restructurings like the one in Brazil, they could be a better option, but until then, this doesn't look that attractive. And now Kinross, they are a Canadian gold and silver miner with operations in the Americas and one project in Africa. They have a production similar to Ashanti, around 2 million ounces, so a bit less, and a production cost similar to Barrick. They expect to maintain a production of around 2 million ounces in the future, but a lower capex starting next year. Now, everyone says that, so take it with a pinch of salt. But if they indeed manage to cut the capex, they can make even 1 billion like in 2020, making it relatively very cheap. They pay a dividend of 12 cents, meaning 2-2.5% per share, and also buy back shares from time to time. They are prioritizing debt repayments right now, which I think is a good idea. They have current assets of 1.8 billion, which is enough to cover the current liabilities like 3 times. Overall, very nice financials, but they have almost 1 billion in provisions. I found a recent lawsuit against them and a subsidiary that can be very expensive and is definitely a risk to consider, and this goes for every other miner out there. So, they are a bit cheaper, despite the company being very good from a financial point of view, but the risk is higher. They also do a lot of exploration and you can never know when they, well, strike gold. This is a general thing to keep in mind with any other miner. Now, Gold Fields, they are a South African company with operations in Africa, Australia and the Americas, and a production and all-in sustaining cost that's very similar to Ashanti's. By the way, this is not the G2 Gold Fields in which Ashanti recently bought a stake. This one is like 100 times bigger than that and is almost twice as expensive as Ashanti. They had an all-in sustaining cost of around 1,300 last year, which is not bad, and a production of 2.3 million ounces that's expected to increase in the near future. They made a free cash flow of 367 million last year, but with a lot of capex and another significant amount of expenditures expected this year. Anyway, without all the projects, they would need around 600-700 million in sustaining capex to stay afloat, which is not terrible for a company that can make over 1.6 billion from operations in the current market. Something I want to point out is that when looking at a company and seeing the all-in sustaining cost and capex and cash flows and so on, it's very important to know what's behind them. For example, with this one, we can see that they expect the all-in sustaining cost to be above 1.4 thousand per ounce this year. However, around 60 bucks per ounce come from a one-time renewable power project, and this is also increasing the sustaining capital and ultimately the capex, which then decreases the free cash flow. If you then look at the headlines a year from now and see such a high production cost, barely any cash flows and so on, you might get a bad idea about the company. The current assets cover the current liabilities only by a bit, but thankfully they don't have a lot of long-term debt, so they shouldn't have that many issues. They recently agreed to sell their stake in a few mining companies, which should bring in a couple hundred million. The dividend, after increasing it a lot lately, is at around 3% today. They're gonna have a new CEO starting this year, so just in case something changes, maybe don't count on it. Anyway, what's different about them is that this is one of the few larger mining companies out there that is relatively not cheap. The market is trading them at like 20 times the cash flow from a very good year, which is twice as expensive as the other companies we looked at. And finally, Agnico Eagle Mines, a Canadian gold miner with operations in Canada, Australia, Mexico and Finland. With a market cap of around 24 billion, they are at a similar size as Barrick and produce around 3.4 million ounces following a record year. The production should stabilize at around 3.5 million ounces in the medium term, and even after increasing a bit, the all-in sustaining cost should be some of the best in the industry at around 1.2 thousand per ounce. This cost of production alone makes it very attractive. The free cash flow was also a new high, reaching around 950 million after 1.6 billion in capex, of which around 700 million was for development. A couple of years ago, they also had a merger with Kirkland Lake Gold, which, again, wasn't really the best time for an acquisition, but we can see a nice increase in production and profits. They have 2.2 billion in current assets, which almost cover the current liabilities and the long-term debt. They have a lot of provisions and deferred tax liabilities, but the non-current assets offset everything like 3 times, so it's not really that big of an issue. What's interesting is that they have been paying a dividend every year since 1983, and it only went up since 2015. Currently, the yield is at around 3.5%, meaning almost 800 million, which is quite an issue for something that's not even that good. If they made, let's say, 2 billion in cash flows today, then sure, it's okay, but at like a billion, they don't have that much room to play, especially if they want to ramp up the developments. This can be sustained, but at the cost of the balance sheet. I had the same issue with ADM, among some other very serious ones, and you know, what if gold gets to 1,500 for, let's say, half a decade? They would make money thanks to the low production cost, but not nearly enough to pay and keep increasing the dividend. When they suddenly accumulate like half a billion in debt per year to be able to pay the dividend and then also having to pay the interest, you can see how this can get pretty ugly. The problem with this one is, once again, the price. There is obviously a premium for quality, but paying the same as you pay for Barrick for a company that made 3 times less money in a record year is not that attractive. I'm comparing the recent highs, by the way, not Barrick's current year. The dividend is a very significant issue in my opinion, but other than that, the company is really good. However, the stock isn't offering a good margin of safety, but again, if gold goes to 2,500 or something, it's not going to matter, but what if it doesn't? It's a shame, really, because if it wasn't for the price and the dividend, this would have probably been the best option in today's video. You know, if Agnico was to merge with Barrick to basically compete with Newmont post Newcrest, that company would be very attractive and the dividend wouldn't be an issue anymore. If they play it right, Agnico can use the relatively high price to make it even a merger of equals, meaning that you as a shareholder would win much more than Barrick. Anyway, here is a summary of what I think about these companies and let me know if you agree or disagree. All of them, with the exception of Agnico if they don't cut the dividend, should be financially healthy enough to be around if gold gets to 2.5 or 3,000 or whatever, and if that happens, any of them could easily be a 3, 4, 5x or even more. As always, what I cover in my videos shouldn't be enough for you to make any investment decision, so please do your own research before investing in anything. If you want to see more videos like this one, please leave a like and even a comment to help me out and make sure to subscribe. Thank you for watching and I'll see you next time.